Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Justice Committee in 2016. The first item on the agenda is consideration of subordinate legislation and seven affirmative SSIs, all in relation to the implementation of the new Scottish Tribunal system. And it's my pleasure to welcome Annabel Ewing, Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, to the committee. This is the Minister's first appearance before the committee. So on behalf of the committee, can I congratulate you on your appointment and look forward to working with you and your team in the future. And I'm sure this will be one of many appearances before the committee. Right, with the Minister this morning is Sandra Wallace and Hannah Frobisher from the Civil Law and Legal System Division, and John St. Clair, Director of Legal Services with the Scottish Government. Just to remind members, officials are permitted to give evidence under this item, but may not participate in the formal debate on the instruments under item 2 on the agenda. Now, I refer members to paper 1 and paper 3 in their papers issued, and ask the Minister if she'd like to make a short opening statement.
Well, thank you, Convener, and it's a pleasure to be here at my first appearance before the committee, and indeed I too look forward to working with the committee over the next years in terms of what I think will be a very busy period for all of us. I would like just to start to refer members to my entry in the Register of Interest, where members will find that I am a member of the Law Society of Scotland and do hold a current practising certificate. I'm pleased to be here today to discuss the suite of fairly technical regulations that will set up the initial structure of the Scottish Tribunals and transfer in the first of its jurisdictions. I will give a brief overview of each of the instruments before you today. So firstly, I would refer the committee to the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland, brackets, Chambers, close brackets, Regulations 2016. These regulations divide the First Tier Tribunal into, at this stage, five chambers, and the chambers are to be the Mental Health Chamber, the Housing and Property Chamber, the Health and Education Chamber, the General Regulatory Chamber, and the Tax Chamber. By separating the first tier into chambers, it protects the specialist knowledge and expertise of the separate jurisdictions. Secondly, I would refer the committee to the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Housing and Property Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland brackets composition, close brackets, Regulations 2016. These regulations specify the type of member who will hear cases in the Housing and Property Chamber. This mirrors the existing composition of the two housing jurisdictions that will transfer into the Scottish Tribunal structure in December of this year. The instrument also sets out the composition of the Upper Tribunal when hearing appeals from the Housing and Property Chamber. The regulations allow for a sheriff to hear appeals. Again, this mirrors the status quo as appeals are currently heard in the Sheriff Court. It will be for the President of Tribunals to determine who hears these appeals. The President may also select herself, Lady Smith is the President at this time, the Chamber President, or indeed the Lord President, if felt appropriate. Thirdly, I would refer the committee to the Scottish Tribunal's brackets offences in relation to proceedings, close brackets, Regulations 2016. These regulations create offences and specify the possible level of fines and terms of imprisonment for committing an offence in proceedings. The aim is to standardise offences across the first tier tribunal, as currently these procedures vary from tribunal to tribunal. And for brevity, Convener, I will summarise the last four sets of regulations together, which are the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland, brackets, transfer of functions of the Private Rented Housing Committee, Private Rented Housing Panel, Homeowner Housing Committee and Homeowner Housing Panel Regulations 2016. These four regulations transfer the functions and members of two housing jurisdictions to the First Tier Tribunal. They also amend existing housing legislation to replace the various references to the committees and panels with rather references to the First Tier Tribunal. The current Tribunal President will transfer into the new structure as the President of the Housing and Property Chamber. In addition, the regulations set out the transitional procedures for cases that are in fact in progress on the date of transfer. As the individual panels and committees are listed separately in the Tribunal Scotland Act 2014, each of these jurisdictions therefore needs to be dealt with by way of separate instruments, and hence the four instruments we've brought to you today. That, in conclusion, Convener, gives, I think, a brief overview of the regulations, and I'm, of course, happy to seek to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That's very helpful. Are there any questions from members? No questions. Minister, do you want to make any closing remarks? No, thanks. We'll move straight to the second item on the agenda today, which is formal consideration of the motions in relation to each of these seven affirmative instruments. Each motion will be moved with an opportunity for a formal debate on each SSI. In practice, I expect that many of the issues will already have been covered, I suppose, but we shall see. Taking each in turn, the first motion, 01516, that the Justice Committee recommends that the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland transfer of functions of the Private Rented Housing Panel Regulations 2016 draft be approved. I invite the Minister to speak and to move the motion.
Thank you, Convener. I would just, having described briefly the instrument in my previous comments, move the motion formally.
Thank you. Are there any comments from members? Does the Minister want to make any closing remarks? No. The question is that motion 01516 in the name of Annabel Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The second motion, 01517, is that the Justice Committee recommends that the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland transfer of functions of the Homeowner Housing Panel Regulations 2016 draft be approved. Minister, do you want to make any opening remarks and move the motion?
No further comments, and I would move formally the motion.
Thank you. Are there any comments from members? No. Does the Minister want to make any closing remarks? No. The question is that motion 01517 in the name of Annabel Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The third motion, 01518, that the Justice Committee recommends that the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Housing and Property Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland Composition Regulations 2016 draft be approved. Do you want to make any opening comments, Minister?
No further comments, and I formally move the motion.
Thank you. Are there any comments from members? No. Ms. Minister, no. The question is that the motion 01518 in the name of Annabel Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The fourth motion is 01519, that the Justice Committee recommends that the Scottish Tribunal's offences in relation to proceeding regulations 2016 draft be approved. Minister, want to make any option?
No further comments, and I formally move
the motion. Thank you. Any comments from members? No. The question is, therefore, I'm assuming you don't want to make any closing remarks. The question is, therefore, that motion 01519 in the name of Annabel Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The fifth motion, 01523, that the Justice Committee recommends that the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Chambers Regulation 2016 draft be approved. Minister, can I invite you to make any comments?
No further comments. I formally move the motion.
Thank you. Are there any comments from members? No. Minister, any closing remarks? No. The question is that motion 01523 in the name of Annabel Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The sixth motion, 01524, is that the Justice Committee recommends that the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland transfer of functions of Homeowner Housing Committee's Regulations 2016 draft be approved. Minister, do you want to make any comments and to move the motion?
No further comments, and I formally move the motion.
Thank you. Are there any comments from members? No. Does the Minister want to make any closing remarks? No. The question is that the motion 01524 in the name of Annabel Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Seventh and final motion under this section is 01525, that the Justice Committee recommends that the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland transfer of functions of the Private Rented Housing Committee's Regulation 2016 draft be approved. Minister, do you want to speak and to move the motion?
No further comments, and I formally move the motion.
Thank you. Are there any comments from members? No. Any closing remarks, Minister? No. The question is that the motion 01525 in the name of Annabel Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. That concludes consideration of these affirmative instruments. The committee report will note and confirm the outcome of the debate on all seven affirmative SSIs. And it only remains for me to thank the Minister and her officials for their appearance before committee today. I now suspend to allow... before I do that, can I just seek the committee's approval for me to delegate authority, to have delegated authority as convener to clear the final draft report. Are you content? Thank you very much. Now suspend the meeting briefly to allow the minister and officials to leave. We're just waiting for the witnesses for the installation. The third item of business today is consideration of two negative SSIs, which are also in relation to the implementation of the new Scottish tribunals, namely the Scottish Tribunal Time Limits Regulations 2016 SSI 2016/231 and Upper Tribunal for Scotland Rules of Procedure Regulations 2016 SSI. I 2016/232. I refer members to paper two. Do members have any comments? No. No comments. Is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to these instruments?
Agreed.
Again, I suspend the meeting briefly to allow the next panel to take their seats. The fourth item of business today is consideration of the Legislative Consent Memorandum on the Investigatory Powers Bill. We'll be hearing today from Police Scotland and then from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. Can I remind members that this is to inform a report to Parliament on whether a legislative consent motion in relation to this bill should be agreed. We'll consider a draft report next week. So I welcome Assistant Chief Constable Steve Johnson and Detective Superintendent Brenda Smith from Police Scotland to the meeting and invite questions from members. John?
Thank you. Good morning and thanks for your attendance. There's always a balance to be struck between pursuit of an inquiry and intrusion into privacy. What options do you consider before you seek some of the authorisations that are available to you?
I think probably the quick answer would be to say we seek all options that are available to us. You know, we look for the most and least intrusive means of conducting the investigation. So that can be everything from normal street patrols and street investigations conducted by our uniform officers, right the way through to covert inquiries and using surveillance units, etc., etc. So we try and explore all the options available to us. If we don't use an option, it's probably been ruled out because we deem that it will actually frustrate the purpose of the inquiry or the investigation in the first instance. So there's a whole range of investigative opportunities for us prior to resorting to this tactic.
Thank you. Are you able to explain what significance is afforded to collateral damage, intrusion into other individuals' privacies when you make decisions about pursuit of certain courses of action?
I think collateral intrusion is one of those things. As the authorising officer, for me, one of the key aims that I have is what is the information or intelligence that we're seeking to identify in this and in terms of the subject of the application. And then the officers will have to tell me where they believe the collateral intrusion will occur and what the level of that intrusion will be. So perhaps an example would be if I'm the subject and I'm living amongst a wider family and I go and visit my mother, my father, you know, that would be deemed collateral intrusion. If I'm gaining information about my mother and father, they're not subject of the application. So I'll be seeking to minimise that by saying, well, actually, if we know the times and dates where that takes place, we'll concentrate our activity on periods of time where we know we can focus in on the subject of the application rather than have other people involved. And we ask the officer to be very specific and very detailed so that we can absolutely minimise the collateral intrusion that we have.
Okay, that's very reassuring. Nonetheless, information will be acquired that's not necessarily pertinent to what you're pursuing. What happens about that?
Can I hand you over to Brenda in terms of how we manage, if you like, the deletion of that material?
Thank you.
So in terms of collateral intrusion, whilst preparing a case for the subject, you're going to prepare a background, do your due diligence round about that to understand if they have family, who the family are, if they stay with each other, in terms of what their lifestyle is, what their activities are. So you have a good understanding of what that individual does in terms of criminal activities. Therefore, when you then monitor that individual, you will have an understanding of what they do. So you can focus in on certain aspects, certain times to minimise the collateral intrusion against that individual. For instance, if they're at home, you would only monitor when they're at home. However, if you do pick up on collateral in relation to members of their family, you can't unknow what you know, but you do not continue with it. You wouldn't collect it and you wouldn't record it.
And do you make a recommendation to the authorising officer? Is that when you're saying you're scoping that background? Is that what
Yes,
you do?
In terms of the application process. In terms of the application process, that would be documented within that, exactly what you've done regarding the background to the individual.
And has there ever been instances where your recommendation hasn't been taken up?
No.
Never?
No.
All right. Can I ask Mr. Johnson also about relations with the UK-wide agencies and the security services? Are you aware of their activities? Have they sought authorisations that you yourselves can seek?
I think if we're working together with those agencies, we'll consider who is the most appropriate agency to submit an application in terms of what it is that we're seeking to achieve, whether it's in Scotland or whether it's in the broader UK. So we work with those colleagues. You know, certainly the principals of the Scottish Crime Campus are, we'll liaise with those other agencies that have the same powers as us so that we're not duplicating effort and that we're actually focusing in on the individuals and not looking twice at the same people. That couldn't happen in terms of the way the application process happens. But we certainly have a dialogue with those agencies as well.
But could it be that they would be the lead agency regarding investigation of crime in Scotland?
Very much depends on what the investigation is, yes, but absolutely. The National Crime Agency or the service could lead in those investigations. And if they do, it either will be in consultation with us around those jobs that we are aware of, but for those that we're not, clearly they'll put their applications in via their own means.
So it is conceivable that there are operations ongoing in Scotland that you're unaware of?
It's conceivable, but normally, as I would say, through the Scottish Crime Campus and the relationships that we have with those other agencies, we were more likely to know about it than not.
Okay, many thanks.
I want to just probe how data is dealt with electronically and some of the implications around that, picking up in particular on what Dr. Smith has just said, that where we have collateral intrusion, we do not collect and do not record data. Now, I just want to probe what that actually means, because presumably where collateral intrusion is involved in circumstances where the data sought and thus collaterally received is electronic, it will have ended up in some form on police computers. Is that, first of all, a reasonable thing for me to assume?
Are we talking about the lawful intercept or the communications data aspect?
Well, in a sense, I could be talking about... It is a more general question, I accept, that goes beyond the bounds of what we're trying to deal with today. So I'm really trying to get some understanding of the operational processes around data, but it is triggered by what's being said in relation to RIP today.
Well, any activity we do is targeted against a specific individual or a group of individuals.
Sure.
Therefore, the authority we have in place is specifically in relation to the authorised purpose, perhaps murder, abduction,
drug dealing, etc.,
against specific individuals. So it is targeted initially. So should there come a set of circumstances where that person is not utilising whatever you are monitoring, then that will be picked up very quickly. And once that's picked up, then it is then discarded. As I've said, you can't unknow what you know, but you do not take that further.
Right. So just to be clear, what really we are being told is if there is data comes to your attention as a police force, it will not be entered into the indexes and case files, but it nonetheless can be present, apparently transiently, on the computer systems of the police force. Right, okay, that's the point I wanted to get to. And I want to just explore what you do under those circumstances. And the first of two points that I want to explore is how is that removed from your computer systems, accepting that it has never reached case files or been indexed as such.
So in terms of, well, there's different types of data because it's different types of intercept communications data. In respect of intercept data, for instance, it would be deleted straight away.
Can I, just before we proceed on that, what does that actually mean? And I ask that, my background is technical, yes. So you will forgive me. In that deletion on a computer system, in essence, involves the removal of the electronic index, but not necessarily the overwriting of the data that may remain on a storage medium. So are you merely using the technology that's available to delete the index, thus leaving the data potentially to be recovered from another part of the storage medium?
The data will be deleted from the system.
Using the facilities of the system?
Yes.
So therefore, the data is not necessarily removed from the electronic medium which it's on. It merely ceases to be accessible.
No, it will be deleted from the system.
Right, okay. I may come back to that. Let me ask the second part. Given that I'm sure, as any professional users of technology would, that you will back up your operating environments and all the data that will be on the disks and other storage mediums that you have, thereby capturing to your backup data, operational data that you may have in a different sense, deleted. How do you deal with the presence of data that may be in historic backups of your electronic system that is actually data which you wish to have deleted?
I think it's a very highly technical area of business. I think when we have systems in which, if we say we've deleted the information, it's deleted in terms of it's not there visible to the officers or myself in terms of our ability in terms of Police Scotland of using that data. In terms of the technology and the binary and all the widgets that sit behind it, I'm not entirely clear about how all that works. But what I will say is our systems and our processes in that regard are all inspected by IOCO in terms of they will come and they will assess how we manage that information, what systems we use to manage that information, and they're all been signed off in terms of our use of those systems. So it's not going to be available. Once we have information that we delete, it's not going to be available to any officers to see. I think potentially the suggestion is, would it be there for somebody to see if we hadn't deleted that? It is deleted. It's not there for Police Scotland to use, and we certainly wouldn't be using the backup systems to go in and try and find data that was previously deleted.
I understand that, and that's quite clear. However, the reason backup systems and backup data files exist is so that in certain operational circumstances they can be restored.
Yes.
How do you prevent the restoration of data from backup undoing the process of deletion that you had undertaken?
I think, that's very technical. I don't have that technical detail. But
Perhaps you might answer after the committee.
And perhaps if there's anything you want to add to your evidence today, then we'd be happy to hear it. But I think you've given really quite a forensic questioning on that particular subject. Oliver, and then followed by Rona.
Hiya, thanks. I wondered if it was possible just to get a bit more general information on your data retention policy, sort of how long you keep things, and how you kind of see that being changed by the proposed bill.
I think data retention is clearly one of those issues that there's no simple answer to this. So in simple terms, if we acquire the data in terms of LI, the data will be converted into a usable intelligence product and then it's deleted from our systems. We have no other access to that. And the intelligence stays on our system for a period of time. In terms of the Scottish Intelligence Database, and that will be there in line with that policy, which is 6 years. But that's not to say that it will get deleted at 6 years. So if that is in relation to a case that has been closed and has been completely dealt with, at that six-year point, it will be reviewed, and if we can delete it, we will delete it. But if that data relates to a cold case or a case that we haven't solved, it's entirely appropriate that we, at that six-yearly point, take that review and say we need to retain that for a lawful purpose. We hold the data legitimately, but it would be wrong to delete that because actually that's not going to be available to the detectives that conduct the cold case reviews some years ahead. So what we will do is have those regular reviews in date. So at the six-year point, we'll do those reviews and we'll extend for a period of time that the investigating officer feels is fit for purpose. Some things we'll keep for life, but that would depend on the sort of appeals process. So it would be for the whole life of that data. But again, that's very specific offences.
We're looking at not the whole provisions of the bill, but the devolved aspects as regards the LCM. Anything else?
No, that's fine.
Okay. Rona?
Yes, I just would like to go back to the warrant question, please, with regard to the interference of property. Where you think that there's an urgent need for a warrant, under what circumstances would you consider not asking for judicial permission?
I think very often we will deal with situations. Kidnapping extortion is a very good example where you have very quickly collapsing time scales. And in that collapsing time scale, we will be seeking authority to try and preserve life in terms of our Article 2 responsibilities. So they're really the only circumstances I can see where there would be an immediate and imminent threat to life where perhaps to slow down that process to go through the whole judicial authority, we would seek, if you like, to get that activity and the information intelligence firsthand, and then get that judicial oversight after that point, which is similar to what happens now. Mm-hmm. But for me, if you like, from the operational perspective, I've got a life that is imminently at threat, and I would seek to preserve that life. So they're the sort of circumstances I would seek to use that power. But again, would always want it checked up by that judicial authority at that point.
Thank you.
Douglas?
Just to follow on Rona's point, can I ask what is the timescale for informing the Judicial Commissioner that you had issued an emergency warrant or an urgent warrant?
So this is under the bill?
Yeah.
So it says within 3 days, but as soon as possible within 3 days.
My understanding is what it says is within 3 days the Judicial Commissioner has to give his view on it. What I'm asking is how quickly do you have to inform the Judicial Commissioner that you have issued an urgent warrant?
I think, well, that's obviously going to be a new process that will be between Scottish Ministers ourselves and the Judicial Commissioners, and that's still to be determined, I would suggest, at this point. But they will be busy with other stuff. We will try and, I would imagine, tell them as soon as possible.
From an operational perspective, and someone that, if you like, is providing that authority as the authorising officer, I'll be seeking that judicial approval as quickly as I can. Because we have a compelling reason to ask for this information. You know, we have a life that is at risk. We are, yes, going very, very quickly to try and preserve that life. But again, the officers are going to have to put the intelligence in and have to put the necessity and proportionality and the due considerations in order to meet that power requirement. So it's not something that I'm going to try and stretch out for the 3 days to see what data I can get. It's in my interest to get that information and intelligence as quickly as I can, but also in terms of lawfully holding that information and that intelligence that I need.
How long could you envisage that taking? Is it minutes, hours, days?
Well, if at 2 o'clock in the morning I get told that somebody's been kidnapped and they're being held at gunpoint in a house somewhere in Scotland, I would love to think that there'll be a judge available at 2:30 in the morning, but there probably isn't. So I can see that being a matter of hours until the morning, until we can get that judge and that judicial process kicked off. But certainly would expect it to have been started within the first few hours. If it's during office hours, things can progress quickly. But again, if it's 2 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday morning, it might be more difficult to do that. So from a Police Scotland perspective, we'll be seeking that authority as quickly as we can possibly get it. What will slow it down is the availability and ability to carry out that second process.
And finally, would there be any thought process or increased thought process thinking that this would be scrutinised within the 3-day period, that you would look for more information before issuing an urgent warrant or approval rather than just presenting a case to a judicial commissioner to do it?
I don't think we'll be asking for any more. I think the process that we currently have, even prior to the bill, I think is a very thorough, very in-depth process. You know, it's currently subject to a review from an authorising officer. It's subject to review from the Cabinet Secretary. Actually, these things are already dealt with as, you know, the most serious intrusions that we can take into somebody's privacy. So I would suggest that the applications themselves, and for us in Police Scotland, very little will actually change, and particularly on an urgent. We might have limited information and intelligence, but we'll still try and build that case in exactly the same way as we do even over the longer period.
Thank you. Mary, on that point,
Can I just ask a follow-up question on that point? If approval is not given for a warrant, does the data and the information that you've collected immediately get destroyed? Given that you've already said that you can't unknow what you know, is it all completely destroyed immediately?
So that data will have been lawfully obtained, and we would seek guidance from the new Judicial Commissioners in relation to that data, whether or not they wanted us to retain that data for inspection by the Judicial Commissioners, or whether they were instructing that the data was deleted there and then.
And could there ever be an instance that information that you gather, even though the warrant has not been approved, could lead to another warrant being issued for something else?
It would depend on the circumstances. We obtain intelligence is very fluid, obviously, and you may obtain intelligence during that period that is relevant to something else, and we're absolutely duty-bound to ensure the safety of the public, so we would react to that.
And you would need to go through the same process again of asking for judicial permission?
Okay. Yeah, there would have to be a second application based on the new intelligence. But once the application is turned down or refused, everything stops after that point.
Okay.
this will be a new process for ourselves, because just now it's to the Scottish ministers, and obviously the judicial process is the new part within the bill. Mm-hmm. So there will be a lot of policy and process that are still to be evened out in respect of that.
Can I ask just in relation to, you said there'll be a lot of new policy, a lot of changes.
Yes.
How confident are you that all the regulations surrounding the new policy will be properly fed down to the officers that will be using it?
Oh, absolutely, yes. No issue with that. Again, in terms of communication, those officers that need to know that to do their job, they'll be informed of that straight away once that has been resolved.
I think part of the problem that we have is it's not a complete bill. So actually, Brenda and I both sit on the UK national groups. I'm on the gold group in terms of making sure that once the bill is complete, and we do need to cascade that learning across all of our officers and all of our staff that are involved, from the strategics perspective, that's chaired by Chief Constable Mick Creedon from Derbyshire, and Brenda sits on the tactical groups to make sure that in relation to the discrete areas of business, so LI, EI and CD, we have the appropriate training that we can deliver for our officers to make sure they're up to date. Part of the problem we have at the moment is we're all planning for something, but we don't know quite what the final version looks like, quite right. But once we do get that, we have systems in place to make sure that those officers, and if you like, starting from the most acute end in terms of those officers that are normally applying for the data, right through the broader population of the police service in Scotland.
Okay. That's encouraging, given communication is a perpetual problem in Police Scotland. Liam.
Mary's covered the point I was going to ask about in relation to the modification of warrants and those instances where the Judicial Commissioner... I mean, I was going to come back to something that Oliver raised earlier, but I think Mary was wanting in on the back of this line of questions. It might be better for...
Yes, Mary?
Because, to be honest, what the line that Mary had asked was what I was going to go down, yeah.
To the area that Oliver was exploring earlier on in relation to the retention of data generally and the six-year time frame that you set out earlier. I mean, clearly there's going to be instances where cases are resolved well within that period, even complex cases. I think some of the concerns that we were covering towards the end of the informal briefing a few weeks ago were around... why it was that the data would simply be retained up until that six-year point where the case had been closed. And I think that the concern, in a sense, it would almost be part of a fishing expedition for subsequent cases. So I think I'd like a bit of reassurance around those instances where cases have been resolved, the data has proved maybe instrumental in leading to the conclusion of that case. But then why it is that Police Scotland would seek to hold on to that data simply to the six-year point when at that point in time there is no real reason for doing so.
It's interesting, you know, we keep other information other than data for those time periods, so it's sort of one policy. Even if somebody has gone through that judicial process, there's potential for appeal, so there's no hard and fast rule. What I can say is we're not holding that data and then subjecting, if you like, to speculative searches at some point in the past. It's held in relation to that case file. In relation to LI, all of the data is deleted, and all that we have, if you like, is an interpretation of the data that is put onto the Scottish Intelligence Database. So it's the actual data that we get through the product is all deleted. At that point, so the most sensitive area. Communications data is linked with the case file and it is subject to that review, so it isn't something that is going to be speculatively searched. It remains with that individual case, and it's not there. But it is exactly the same as other elements of information that we hold in relation to the case file, so whether that be paper files and traditional types of information that we hold.
But from recollection, you were talking about information that may be relevant to another case being subject to a separate application and drawn that's held. So I think you maybe understand why there's a degree of a concern that there's a sort of contamination across different processes with the same information that's been gathered for one reason but finds itself being deployed for other reasons in another case. And that if you have a fairly arbitrary time frame of 6 years, then in a sense it's not proportionate in a timeframe sense, to the case that was used to back up the original application. It's simply being held because 6 years is kind of the timeframe that you've agreed is the arbitrary timeframe you're going to operate in. I mean, that just doesn't seem entirely satisfactory.
I'm not entirely sure it's entirely arbitrary in terms of history will tell us that actually the retention periods, very often you can be asked for information or in relation to that case, or people can actually review that case for other reasons, not just Police Scotland, beyond those dates. I can go away and have a look at those retention policies and make sure that they do meet those scrutiny. But again, our retention policies are part of the subject of the inspection that we have from IOCO. And they're content with it at this stage in terms of that, if you like, that separate view. But again, that could be something, if you like, for the Judicial Commissioner in the future to make comment on in terms of how we retain that information. But there is no nefarious activity from Police Scotland in relation to the data that we hold.
Yeah, can I perhaps follow up on that? We've had a submission from EHRC, and they quite rightly point out the intrusions into privacy of persons who are not suspected of wrongdoing are unlawful unless absolutely necessary and proportionate. So I suppose the question is what specific tests are undertaken to ensure that it is absolutely necessary and proportionate when you're looking into privacy, when you're doing interference?
So in terms, the first test is necessity. Yeah. So is there a legitimate aim? And that is for the prevention and detection of serious crime. And once that criteria is met, then, if you like, the responsibility of the authorising officer is to balance that proportionality into the intrusion of the person's private life and what is we're seeking to achieve in terms of the legitimate aim, in terms of that prevention and the detection of crime. And that balance takes... It's not a quick process. You know, each individual subject has different needs, has different elements that may impact on them. So the size of the family, you've asked the question about collateral intrusion. If it's a very focused individual application where we have little in terms of collateral intrusion, and this is about a subject who is engaging in serious and organised crime, potentially human trafficking, you know, the most serious offences that we have, that will be very focused on those individuals, and it will be providing intelligence about those individuals, and the opportunity for collateral damage is minimised. Again, we've already heard of the processes that we can put in place where if collateral intrusion does occur, that we delete that information and then it's not held any further. So right from the point of the application, we focus in on the individuals that we need, and I'll take the balance in decision around the intrusion into their rights and what it is they're doing in terms of their ongoing criminal activity that balances up against the intrusion into their private and family life, against the criminality and the harm that they're causing to the community. And in the vast majority of those cases, it is a balance between an individual's Article 8 rights and my Article 2 duties in terms of preservation of life. You know, there's a sad fact, a lot of these applications are around people who are involved in human trafficking, they're involved in the importation and supply of Class A drugs. On average, two people every day will die in Scotland in relation to drugs-related deaths. Now, I have to balance that against the intrusion on these people's rights who we know, to some degree, are importing Class A drugs, new psychoactive substances, and the intrusion into their article right for privacy, and yet trying to keep the people of Scotland safe, who are dying on average two a day in relation to drug-related deaths. And that balancing picture is there, and the information is there. I don't use old data. I use the current data that's available to me about those competing demands. And I understand that will come under scrutiny both from... the Scottish Government and also from the judiciary in the future. And I welcome that, you know, because it shouldn't be right that I have that right to intrude on people's privacy carte blanche, and I take it very seriously.
Yeah, I understand competing rights, and clear messages coming out that the necessary and proportionate test is always looked at before a warrant is granted and applied for. Thank you very much. That concludes our questioning, and I thank ACC Johnson and Detective Superintendent Smith for attending this morning. I now suspend to allow the next panel of witnesses and the Cabinet Secretary to take their place. I work with Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Justice, to the committee. This is also the Cabinet Secretary's first formal meeting with the committee, although he has met with us privately. He's accompanied today by Graeme Walk, Defence Security and Cyber Resilience Division, and Laurie Mitchell, Directorate of Legal Services, Scottish Government. For the record, Laurie is also my niece, who I haven't seen for months. She never writes, she never calls. So you're doubly welcome here this morning, Laurie. Before I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he wishes to talk to the LCM, can I just put on record that the committee has received two letters in the last few days from the Cabinet Secretary addressing recent developments in relation to the UK Investigatory Powers Bill, and the committee has published these letters on its website. Cabinet Secretary, do you want to make an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. I promise to keep my introductory remarks brief. The Scottish Government has been clear that we fully support law enforcement agencies and the security and intelligence agencies having access to the powers they require, so long as these powers are proportionate and subject to the appropriate safeguards and level of oversight. The areas of the bill that are subject to the LCM are about maintaining the status quo, clarifying the existing law, and putting in place an enhanced oversight regime in the form of an Investigatory Powers Commissioner, supported by a number of Judicial Commissioners. Those Commissioners will all be serving or retired senior judges. I'm aware that concerns have been expressed relating to aspects of bulk powers, and I share some of those concerns. However, these are reserved powers and are matters for the UK Government and the UK Parliament. These are not matters that Scottish Ministers or the Scottish Parliament can determine. I provided further information yesterday to the committee on the matter of the technological advisory panel. This is being included in the bill in order to implement the recommendation made by David Anderson QC in his review of the bill's built powers. It is unfortunate the UK Government's amendments, which extend to Scotland, continue to come forward at this late stage of the bill's progress. However, I'm sure the committee will appreciate this is a complex piece of legislation, and despite the issues around timing, which are beyond our control, I've been keen to ensure that members of the committee have all the information they require in order to aid their understanding of the matters that are subject to the LCM. And I'm, of course, happy to answer any questions from committee members.
Invite questions from members. John?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Morning. Panel. Cabinet Secretary, I share these concerns that you expressed in the letter about the bulk powers, and I know that's, we may be told that's not what we're addressing today, but they do have an operational effect in Scotland, yet David Anderson's conclusion is that there is a distinct but yet not yet proven operational case for the powers that's been. Is that where your reservations come for these powers?
In part, and that's why we reserved our position until the further review had been carried out by David Anderson, and he's come forward with the specific recommendation that the technological advisory panel should be established in order to advise and inform the new commissioner on any action that can be taken in order to address some of the ongoing technological advances that come about, which reduce some of the potential risks which are associated with the bulk powers. And that's why I think it's it was right to reserve our position until we had the further review carried out by David Anderson on this matter. And I think his recommendation is a welcome one, which as I've also said in the letter, I'm keen for the technological advisory panel to also be able to advise Scottish ministers in these matters. And the engagement we've had so far with the Home Office and taking that forward has been productive and helpful in seeking to make sure that they can also advise ministers on these issues.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. In the previous evidence session, we heard from ACC Johnson. I asked him about the potential for UK-wide organisations, the Security Services and others, the National Crime Agency, to be involved in operations in Scotland that Police Scotland were unaware of. And he did talk about the level of cooperation, but he did acknowledge that that could be the same. Have you any concerns about the roles or the function that they might fulfil in Scotland that you would be bypassed, the Lord Advocate could be bypassed?
Well, in relation to the Security and Intelligence Services.
And the Crime Agency.
And National Crime Agency. Yes. Well, the National Crime Agency, in order to be directly involved in operational matters, require consent from the Lord Advocate. So there is a clear process there for their role in Scotland, given the nature of their jurisdiction. So they do require the expressed consent of the Lord Advocate in their engagement in criminal activities in Scotland. With regards to the Security and Intelligence Services, as you'll appreciate, the vast majority of the work which is undertaken by these services relates to matters primarily which are focused on issues relating to national security. And as a result, any authorisations which they require for their work in that area, including within Scotland, would be matters for the Home Secretary. However, where they're engaged in work with Police Scotland to deal with the prevention or detection of serious crime, then they're matters which, when it comes to interception, they would require the authorisation of Scottish ministers. And clearly, with the additional measures around bulk powers and the way in which they can interrogate some of that information, part of that will also require authorisation from Scottish ministers. So I actually think by the extension of some of the responsibilities of Scottish ministers in this area, it will helpfully provide us with a greater oversight of some of the activity that they could be involved in relating to the prevention and detection of serious crime.
And do you see benefit and UK oversight rather than specifically just Scottish oversight?
As in relation to them, national security matters?
No, as in relation to the Investigatory Powers Commissioners and their UK-wide remit.
Yeah, I think it's helpful in having... We have the three commissioner system at the present moment, so moving to a single commissioner, I think, is the logical step in drawing together all that single expertise into a single body, I think, is the right approach. And I think operating on a UK basis at the present moment is probably the best approach, given the nature of the reserved matters which are dealt with within the Investigatory Powers Bill.
OK, thank you very much.
Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. I did probe the police in the previous evidence session about some of the technological issues around how they deal with data which comes to their notice, which is out with what they're allowed to have and to keep. And I was satisfied, I think, I'm not saying my committee colleagues were, but I was satisfied that procedurally the police had appropriate procedures in place to ensure that it did not enter into consideration, into files, criminal files, and so on and so forth. But I was left with one technical issue, which perhaps might be for Mr. Waugh to deal with and perhaps even take away. And that is how, in relation to whole system backups, which most computer managers will undertake to ensure they can restore in the case of destruction of whole systems, the unwinding of deletions so that data becomes reavailable, and what processes that were in place to ensure that that didn't happen. I'll ask two questions just to get it out of the way. And the other question is, given the existence of the Technological Advisory Panel, clearly that will be a source of considerable expertise on a whole range of issues. Will the deliberations and knowledge that come out of that be more widely available to departments in government who are involved in legal enforcement of a range of issues where, quite outside the RIP, similar issues will arise? Is there an opportunity there that arises from what's happening in the RIP?
Okay, on your first point, I would certainly bow to your greater IT knowledge than mine, and I suspect, in fairness to Graham, even his as well, but I understand the point you're making in terms of the potential to unwind deleted details on the system. I don't know where Graham wants to say much about that, but it may be something that we'd have to come back to you with some further technical information on if that would be helpful.
Yeah, I'm afraid if I've given you the impression that I know anything about such technical matters, I can only apologise. We can certainly look into it further, probably with Police Scotland, and come back to committee on that point.
We're going to get too much further on that.
Sentence, I'm not trying to be technical. I'm really looking for procedural issues.
We'll come back to you on that specific point. Can I return to your second point, and that is around the technological advisory panel? And, yes, there is the potential, because, of course, there's a regulation for Investigatory Powers Act, and there's the regulation for Investigatory Powers Act Scotland, which is utilised by a range of bodies in Scotland that are able to exercise powers through that legislation. So, for example, it can be used in tackling environmental crimes, where they can use covert means for the purposes of looking to try and build up intelligence and evidence. It can be used, for example, by local authorities to deal with issues, including matters that could relate to, for example, domestic disturbances, etc. as well. So they are governed, and there's regulations around that whole process. One of the reasons that I think it would be helpful for the Technological Advisory Panel to be able to advise Scottish ministers as well is that it's got a very specific remit, and part of its remit will be to look at, as technology advances and develops, other ways in which we can still undertake this type of work, but it minimises the risks even further of unintended or unnecessary intrusion as well. And I think having access to that information could assist us in informing public bodies in Scotland, along with Police Scotland, on some of those alternative technologies as they develop and come forward. So the simple answer is yes, and that's one of the primary reasons that I would like it to also be extended to Scottish ministers.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. A little like yourself and John Finney earlier, I think I would want to put on record the serious misgivings I have about aspects of this bill, particularly in relation to bulk data. But focusing on the areas that we're required to look at under the LCM, there's been a fair bit of discussion about the collateral impact of this sorts of surveillance. And what reassurances can you give the committee that in that respect, those who are not the target of any investigation, but who may be impacted by some of the provisions in this bill, that will be minimised, and where information, where data is gathered, that will be dealt with appropriate, presumably by deletion in whatever form Stuart probably thinks is appropriate and final.
I think that does lead into part of the concerns we have around some aspects of the built powers and how they may operate. The aspects of the built powers which will be dealt with by Scottish ministers will be that information which has been obtained through the process of utilising the built powers, if they wish to examine some of that information relating to a targeted individual, then they will require a authorisation from Scottish ministers and also from the judicial oversight. So that's the element which we will deal with. I do think there is when interception warrants are being considered at the present time, the whole issue of collateral intrusion is a matter which is considered at the time of application. How can that be minimised? You have already heard from Police Scotland the procedures they have in place so that should they obtain any information during the course of any type of interception activity that does not relate to the subject that the warrant was actually dealing with, is that they've got a process in place for dealing with that information and deleting and discarding that information. But it is a matter which is considered at the very outset when Police Scotland are even applying for the warrant in the first place. It's then an issue which is considered by ourselves once it comes into our officials who deal with these matters within the Scottish Government, and then when it's presented to myself as well, it's an issue, and the actions which have been taken in order to minimise the risk of that happening as well. So it is already part of the process at the existing time to try and minimise that. I think that goes back, though, to the point I was making around the technological advisory panel, is that as technology develops in advance, there is maybe scope to actually look at helping to reduce that even further. And that's where I think it would be useful for us to have access to that advice as and when that develops.
And in terms of the judicial approval you refer to in relation to warrants or the modification of warrants, I suppose one of the other issues that have been raised with us is that there may well be instances, as there are at present, where Police Scotland feel they have to act very speedily and the opportunity to gain that prior approval is limited. Now, I think we can all understand why those circumstances perhaps arise, but what's not entirely clear is the length of time that will is likely to be necessary to gain that approval. And in those instances where approval isn't subsequently granted, either in whole or in part, for the actions, what the consequences of that are for the investigation and any data that has already been accumulated as a result of the actions that Police Scotland's taken?
I suppose, well, it depends on what type of warrant they're applying for. So, for example, if Police Scotland are applying for an interception warrant that requires to come to Scottish ministers or under the new system also will be considered by a judicial commissioner. If it's an urgent matter, so for example, if there's a threat to life and they have to act swiftly, the process at the present time is they still require ministerial authorisation. So before they can start to take that forward, and we have a process in place at the present time where if there was a requirement at 2 o'clock in the morning for the police to be able to get a warrant for the purpose of interception because of an urgent incident developing, that we have a process where they are able to contact a senior official within Scottish Government, and that senior official in Scottish Government would by and large come to myself for that authorisation to take place. So there's a process for dealing with that. And then what happens is that the paper trail that goes with that then catches that up as quickly as possible. So there is a process for dealing with those types of urgent authorisations, but it still requires ministerial authorisation. The new element will be the judicial commissioner's role in that. And as you'll be aware, within the legislation, there's a three-day period when the judicial commissioner should have been able to consider the matter. Part of this is a new process which is being created. There are still some practical measures which will need to be taken forward in order to try and make sure that where there's an urgent request is that we are able to get access to one of the judicial commissioners in Scotland as quickly as it can happen. So although the 3 days is almost a backstop, is that the principle of operating it will be is for it to be done as quickly as possible. But notwithstanding being able to get access to a judicial commissioner within a couple of hours, is that they still require ministerial authorisation on interception matters. When it comes to other types of warrants, whether it be equipment interference or property interference, they don't require ministerial authorisation. Equipment interference requires judicial commissioner authorisation after it's been considered by a senior officer, very often the chief constable, or someone, I believe, of the rank above superintendent that is authorised to consider these matters. They would then have to go to the judicial commissioner for authorisation in these matters as well. On property interference, these are matters that are dealt with by senior officers within within the police service. There is not a judicial authorisation process element to that. There never has been, and it's always been dealt with in internally. So the issue would be, so for example, picking up, I think the concern that you're raising would be is that if the police had an urgent matter where they had to exercise, if they had to exercise some form of equipment interference on an urgent basis, then they would have to go for judicial authorisation on that matter. If they weren't able to get it in that time frame, they would have to go for that retrospectively. Again, if it was a case of a threat to life, an example could be a a child being abducted or an individual being abducted, where it's very fast moving and they have to move quickly to try and get information quickly on the matter, where that can be followed up. And then once the The Judicial Commissioners considered that issue. They then considered whether the information which they've gained during the period of that time, whether that, if they've approved it, that's fine. If they have not, then the Judicial Commissioner has her own determining what happens with the information they've gathered during that period of time as well. So there is a safeguard in there, but it's trying to create a system which is agile enough to be able to respond to very rapidly developing operational matters, while at the same time also trying to provide the right type of oversight to pick up in these matters as and when that's necessary.
That's helpful. I mean, there's clearly, as a result of ACC Johnson's evidence earlier on, there's a clear concern about activities happening at 2 o'clock in the morning, which I hope both Police Scotland and Scottish Government are staffed up to deal with. But the process that I think
we have an on-call system.
I'm sure you do. The process you've described, I suspect, covers the vast majority of those instances where, as you say, there needs to be an agility to respond to fast-moving events. I think the concern would be that it begins to look almost like a rubber-stamping exercise, and actually the process of either ministerial approval and/or judicial oversight in this process is about putting in place a challenge function, if you like, and ACC Johnson, I think, was very candid in saying that that's as it should be, there shouldn't be a carte blanche. So even in a fast-moving situation, even when the risk assessed by Police Scotland is severe, whether life-threatening or whatever, I think there still needs to be a reassurance that where either ministers or those exercising judicial oversight have concerns about the actions taken by Police Scotland, that this will have effect, and there will be consequences of that for the actions that have been taken, sort of leading up to that point of decision by ministers or by judicial oversight.
Well, look, I think it's also worth keeping in mind here is that this process has also got the oversight from the Investigative Powers Commissioner, who will be able to come in and be able to inspect these matters. So they will be able to look at the process, a bit like the way in which IOCO do at the present time, is to go in and to inspect the processes that Police Scotland have got, the processes that we have in government and how we handle them as well. I meet with them to discuss our approach as well, and they report on these issues. So there is that. There is also that retrospective aspect of it being inspected and ensuring that where you have a situation that authorisations have been given and there are, as you say, it may feel for some people it's a rubber stamp process. One thing I can assure you of is that I don't act as a rubber stamp when it comes to ones that are coming before me. It's very clear, and the legislation is very clear, both necessity and proportionality have to be met in order to justify any form of interception, because it is a considerably intrusive means of getting into someone's private life. And the new legislation is very clear about that as well. So from our perspective, in applying for it, and coming into the team in government and considering it, that's got to be considered. If they don't think it's been considered properly and there's sufficient information to justify both necessity and proportionality, it will go back and it will be refused on that basis. Once my officials have considered the matter and it's then put to me, I then consider that as well. And if I'm not satisfied, it would be refused as well. So, and I've got absolutely no doubt that additional measure of judicial oversight will be considering exactly that similar information. So, these are dealing with incredibly serious matters, and the authorisation process in it should not in any way be considered or viewed as any form of rubber stamp. It's a very detailed process that we go through. However, the process when it comes to dealing with urgent matters is dealt with in a much more rapidly way, but nevertheless, the issue of necessity and proportionality as set out in the legislation still has to be met in those circumstances. And when it comes to interception, illegal interception of communications is a criminal act and is within the legislation at the present time and will be within the new legislation. So I can offer you that reassurance, is that it's a very robust process, and it's one which is applied very rigorously, and is certainly one which we seek to make sure the safeguards which are in the existing legislation are properly and fully met, and it would be the same with the new legislation. And the additional reassurance you can have of that is the role that at the present time IOCO have, and that the new investigatory powers commissioner will have in being able to have oversight of these matters and how they've been handled.
Thanks.
Now, could I ask the Cabinet Secretary about the letter you sent yesterday and about the amendments that will be put down by the UK government, and I understand there's dialogue with you and your officials on that. But you add in a sentence in the unlikely event that the amendment were drafted in such a way that contradicted the information that the government are giving to Parliament, you would reject it. Can I ask if that is just a catch-all sentence that is always put in, or are there genuine concerns of contradictions that could be put into that amendment that maybe we as a committee should be aware of?
So what we have saw is we have saw the drafting instructions that have gone to Parliamentary Council on the amendment which the UK government intend to introduce to the bill. What we haven't saw is the finalised amendment. The other part is that we've also gone back to them with the suggestion that the technological advisory panel should be able to advise Scottish ministers. If it's going to advise Scottish ministers, then Scottish ministers would have to be consulted on the appointment of that technological advisory panel. And that's the discussions which we're having with them at the present time. Now, if given where we're at and the whole process and discussing this with the Home Office, if the Home Office were then to say, actually, we're not going to implement David Anderson's recommendation, given that it was one of the issues that we had concern about and we'd reserved our position on, it would seem reasonable that until we've actually saw the amendment that's going to go into the actual bill, that we say that we're happy with how things are progressing at the present moment, but once we've saw the final amendment, we'll then be in a position to be able to give our consent to that. However, should the Home Office change their position on that, it would seem reasonable that I should then come back to the committee and advise you of any change in their approach.
But just to confirm, the contradiction would be not taking forward David Anderson's recommendation on block, rather than, or would you say you would reject it just if Scottish ministers weren't involved?
No, it's just to do with the technological advisory panel.
The whole thing?
Yes, to do with the technological advisory panel and the recommendation that they should be able to advise. I think...
And that would be unlikely, given that they're putting down amendments on that subject.
Yeah, I think it's highly unlikely, and I think the UK government have also expressed publicly their position on this matter as well. So this is largely purely because we have not saw the actual final draft of the amendment that will go into the legislation. So if that was to change, then clearly we would have a view on that matter, and that's to give us the opportunity to come back to the committee should there be a change in that position.
That concludes our question, Cabinet Secretary. Can I thank you and your officials for attending today? I now suspend the meeting to allow the Minister and his officials to leave. is public petitions, and I refer members to paper 6. Can I remind members that if they wish to keep a petition open, they should indicate how they would like the committee to take it forward, or if they wish to close a petition, they should set out their reasons for doing so. I propose to consider the petitions in the order they're set out in paper 6. The first is PE1501 and PE1567, investigating unascertained deaths, suicides and fatal accidents. These petitions are discussed on pages 2 and 3 of the clerk's paper, and the committee is asked to consider and agree what, if any, action it wishes to take in relation to the petitions. Options include the committee could close the petition on the basis that the Scottish Government, COPFS, has made its position clear on the petitions. Alternatively, in view of the fact of the change in leadership of COPFS, the committee could keep the petition open in order to ascertain from new leadership whether there is now any difference in their view on the petitions. However, I seek members' views. Liam? Stuart?
Thanks, Convener. I thought the note was very helpful, and I confess I've only had a chance to dip into some of the background to this, but I was struck by the additional information provided by Stuart Graham, one of the petitioners, in relation to the relative figures for such inquests in a range of jurisdictions. And it does appear that Scotland, probably along with territories in Canada, are markedly out of step with either other parts of the UK, Republic of Ireland and states in Australia that are referred to here. I mean, I think from my perspective, I'd be quite interested to get an understanding as to why there is this marked discrepancy. I think the earlier letter from the Cabinet Secretary is helpful in setting out what the background of such or the objective of such inquests actually is in terms of the public interest. But nevertheless, presumably there is a public interest in such inquests in these areas, in these territories and jurisdictions as well. And therefore, I think from my own perspective, before we make a decision whether to finally close the petition, I would certainly wish to seek from Scottish Government some sort of better understanding as to why those differences in the numbers are as they are.
Okay, Stuart, then Douglas.
I take a different view. In particular, I refer to the letter from Frank Mulholland of the 25th November 2015, which addresses precisely the point that's been raised on the first page. It's page 8 in our Annex A. Precisely describes why there is a difference, acknowledges that there is a difference. I do have some limited personal experience of this, unfortunately, although in fairness, in relatively straightforward circumstances in terms of investigation and legality, which I felt worked for myself and my relatives. And on the basis that the information that Liam MacArthur was seeking is there in the letter from Frank Mulholland, I would personally suggest that the government's position is clear and we should close these petitions at this time.
Douglas?
I take a different view from Stuart, and I'd like further information. First of all, it's mentioned in... I'm doing it online, so I'm not sure exactly which page, about the members' bill in the House of Commons that did address some of the concerns I think maybe Stuart is raising about the high number elsewhere in the UK. But I wonder, what was the outcome of that members' bill? Do we have any information on that? Is
it Patricia Ferguson's members who raised here, or is it House of Commons?
No, I understand it's the House of Commons.
No, I'm not aware of that.
So it would be interesting to know if the position has changed down there as a result of that. I also wanted a bit more information on full disclosure. I'm dealing with an extremely complex constituency case at the moment, which is with Police Scotland, but there is some significant concerns about the disclosure of information. So if you read the letter, which Stuart Stevenson is very happy to support, from the former Lord Advocate, you'd think families you know, are entitled to pretty much everything, the experience I've had is not the case, and therefore I think we need more information about full disclosure. If the new Lord Advocate is of the same opinion as his predecessor, I'd be interested to know how often full disclosure is not given to relatives, because that is a way to resolve an issue. But if we don't have full disclosure, then families will continue to come to us with these types of petitions, and I'd be keen to get more information on those aspects before we decide how to further conclude this petition.
John, then Mary.
I thought Frank Mulholland's letter was very comprehensive. I don't think it's going to be easy to satisfy the petitioners at all. It's always each individual case and its individual merits, and that's where the statistics I find aren't. It's not too easy to deal with. I wonder, given that one of the consequences of the work that was done by the committee, indeed Patricia Ferguson with her, was this charter, whether there's an opportunity to perhaps leave the petition open to see what response, if any, there is to the revised charter about relations. I mean, it's not specifically going to deal with the concerns raised by the petitions, but it might give us pointers as to whether there's continuing issues.
Okay, Mary, followed by Rona.
I'll be very brief, convener, because I share the view expressed by Liam, and I would like a bit more information about the discrepancy in numbers of FAIs that are carried out in Scotland as opposed to other countries. And I've read Frank Mulholland's letter a couple of times, and while it almost gives us the bare facts, I don't think he goes into enough detail, and I would certainly like more information to have a better understanding before we made a final decision.
Okay. And Rona.
Yeah, I'm sort of minded to go down the route that Stuart's discussing, but I think it would be useful for us to go to the Crown Office just, you know, to find out if what their view on it is, given that it's, you know, it's a new broom there. I think it would... before any closure, we should certainly do that. That would be my opinion.
Yeah, I think the committee is minded to keep it open. I must admit, I shared Stuart's view probably to begin with, given the charter was there and where we are and view of what John said. But I do think the points raised are valid and there is merit in keeping it open. So we agreed we continue this and seek the information that's been asked for. Okay, thank you. Right. The second petition is PE1370, Independent Inquiry into the Megraki Conviction. This is discussed on pages 3-5 of the clerk's paper. The clerks have ascertained from Police Scotland that the timetable in relation to Operation Sandalwood has slipped since the 11th March letter referred to in paragraph 23 of the clerk's paper. Police Scotland recently informed the clerks by telephone that owing to complex live issues, the report has not yet been completed and passed to the Deputy Chief Constable. The previous committee were informed in March that the report was expected to reach DCC, the DCC around mid-May. The committee is asked to consider and agree what, if any, action it wishes to take in relation to the petition. Options include the option of closing the petition on the grounds that the Scottish Government has already made its position clear, or keep the petition open. If so, it might wish to consider writing to Police Scotland seeking clarity on the future timetable of completion of Operation Sandalwood. Invite comments and views from members. Stuart.
I don't think we can close it until Sandwood is complete.
Any other views? Seems that's the majority of the committee. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I just wonder just how far the investigation into Sandalwood will take us, given I think the inquiry is asking for the government to hold an inquiry and the government has made its position clear.
Just to take it a little bit further, I'm not expecting that I would wish to keep it open after we hear that, but I think in all fairness, and until we hear what Sandwood, I'm very reluctant for politicians of any character to interfere in the independence of the judiciary, to be blunt. But I think there is a case for keeping it open until we see what Sandwood comes up with.
John Finney.
I agree with a lot of what Stuart says. But the reality is these are a very unique set of circumstances and we need to understand process. Yeah. So forget the individual whose name's in it, and I know, Convener, you've heard me say this many, many times. It is about process. There are a unique set of circumstances. There's a unique inquiry with, as we hear, complex and live issues. I think we need to understand how that inquiry is going to continue and how it's going to go ahead. I think I take some reassurance from a change of personnel, certainly at Lord Advocate level, and I imagine that the Justice of McGrahy people do too. But we need to understand the process where an aggrieved party has issues with those charged with making important decisions about criminal prosecution goes. And this may be the model that we need to look at for the future.
Of the committee appears to be to keep the petition over until we hear the inquiry from Sandwood. Are we agreed we do that?
Yes,
agreed. Okay. All right, the third and final set of petitions is PE1510 and PE1511, Police and Fire Control Rooms. The last two petitions before us today are discussed on pages 6 and 7 of the clerk's paper. Annexes G and H provide the latest information in relation to proposals for North of Scotland control rooms. The committee is asked to consider and agree what, if any, action it wishes to take in relation to these petitions. Can I have views from members? Liam?
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I mean, specifically in relation to the one regarding police control rooms, I think there were assurances given, not least around the controversies and difficulties in other control rooms, that any transfer of staff and operations from Inverness and Aberdeen would only take place once the new premises and operations were open and functioning in Dundee. I don't think that that is the case. I'm led to believe that there are interim provisions for housing some of the staff from Aberdeen and Inverness, and therefore I think at the very least I would want some understanding as to what it is that Police Scotland are doing and why it is that the earlier undertakings not to give effect to this transfer until things had been set up and robustly tested don't appear to have been fulfilled.
Any other views? John Finney?
Thank you, Convener. I think that call handling is going to be a factor that's going to come up as a result of the M9 incident, and I think it would need to understand the relationship with that. There was additional tasks going to be allocated to Inverness. It might be helpful to clarify if these tasks have been allocated there. There certainly is, it seems to be an issue around resilience, so I would suggest we keep them open meantime.
Stuart Stevenson?
There are issues still to be resolved. They should be kept open. Yeah.
I think there is other information being stored, just the robustness of the process, if I understand you right, Liam. Yeah.
I would agree with John's comments as well. I mean, there's probably additional issues we can pursue, but my understanding was that partly around what had happened with the transfer of call handling elsewhere, that there was an undertaking from Police Scotland to make sure that this transfer was not happening until the new setup had been fully set up and was robustly tested, because I think that was one of the concerns that had emerged in relation to the M9.
Right. Is the committee agreed we keep this petition open pending the additional information sought?
Yes.
Thank you. That concludes business for today. The next meeting of the committee will be on 4th of October, and I now formally close this meeting.